And you're all that we want. You're all that we need. You're all that we want. You're all that we need. We know where the Spirit of the Lord is.
The Spirit of the Lord is there is liberty.
We know living in your freedom.
Good morning, everyone. Okay, I got 4 out of 100. Good morning, everyone. Oh, that's more gooder, as we say down south. We are just happy to be here in the house of God. As I say every Sunday, feel free to worship the way you worship in your home church. If you feel like standing, stand. If you feel like raising your hands, raise your hands. Whatever you feel like doing, this is all about focusing on Jesus Christ this morning. We're just going to have a great praise and worship this morning. Will you sing with me this morning? Because I don't like to sing alone. That's why I invited you. How many people know God is great? So let's sing about how great our God really is.
The splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, darkness tries to hide, trembles at his voice, and trembles at his voice. How great is our God! Sing with me, how great is our God! And all will see how great is our God! And time is in His hands, beginning and the end, beginning and the end. The Godhead three in one, Father, Spirit, Son, the Lion and the Lamb, the Lion and the Lamb. How great is our God! Sing with me, how great is our God! And all will see how great is our God! Great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And all will see how great is our God. Name above all names. Our God, name above all names, He is worthy of all praise, and my heart will sing how great is our God. How great is our God! Sing with me, how great is our God! And all will see how great is our God!
Hallelujah. Let's give the Lord a hand clap this morning, because He is great. He is great. Why don't we ask God this morning to open the eyes of our heart? Can we do something this morning? Can we clap a little bit this morning? Is that all right? It's okay. I want to make sure Jesus hears us.
Open the eyes of my heart, I want to see You. I want to see You. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart, I want to see You. I want to see
you where?
To see You high and lifted up, singing like the light of Your glory. Pour out Your power and love as we sing, holy, holy, holy. High and lifted up, shining like the light of Your glory. Pour out Your power and love as we sing, holy, holy, holy. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see You. I want to see You. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see You. I want to see You. To see see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out our power and love as we sing, holy, holy, holy. High and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, holy, holy. High and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, holy, holy. Sing this with me. Holy, holy, holy. Your turn. I want to see you. Come on, sing it out. To see you one more time. Holy, 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 holy. I want to see you. Sing this out again. Holy, 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 holy. I want to see you. To see you high and lifted up. See you high and lifted up. Shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, holy, holy. High and lifted up. Shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. Yes, Lord. Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. I want to see.
How many people want to see him? Oh, I look forward to the day that I see him face to face. That's going to be wonderful. And all the troubles and cares of this world will be far behind us. And we'll just be able to worship at his feet for all of eternity. That's a beautiful thing. It's a beautiful thing to worship for all of eternity. So, if you're here today, we're here to worship. So we're going to sing, Here I Am to Worship. Now remember, it's a little full now, so if you worship with your hands up, that's fine. Just praise the Lord. This is the place we can do it. We live in a country where we have freedom to worship any way we want, and that's a beautiful thing.
Light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see. Beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you. So here I am to worship. Here I am. to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. King of all days, oh so highly exalted, glorious in heaven above. Humbly you came to the earth you created, for love's sake became poor. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. So I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross, upon the cross, Jesus, upon the cross. Oh, so here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, sing it, here I am to say, my God, you're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. Sing it. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow. Say that you're my God.
What is he?
Altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me.
Now sing out so the heavens can hear. So
here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. You're my God. altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. Hallelujah, hallelujah. We worship you for who you are. We worship you. Hallelujah, hallelujah. We worship you for who you are. For who you are.
Good morning. How are you? Oh, come on. 8:30 is so wide awake, and you guys go, all right, we're all right. How are you this morning?
Great.
Great, yes. You have a commander here in the house tonight. He's really going to inspire you to be great, let me tell you. Let's just bow our heads and pray to start our service. Okay. Father, we thank you for one more time gathering us together. We thank you, Father, that you've brought these two mighty men of God to speak into our life, to lead us into worship. Father, prepare our hearts that as Larnell worships and brings us your heart through that, and the general speaks to us, stir our hearts with what you've put in us today, Lord, for what you would have us to do. Let the word grow in us, and let it bring forth great fruit. And we thank you, Lord, for bringing us here today one more time. Amen.
Well, we're going to have our opening special music where everybody can participate now that almost everybody's here. If you would just stand with me this morning, and we're just going to sing. How many people believe that we are overcomers? Well, that didn't sound too fantastic, but we are overcomers. See, I've read the book. At the end, it says we win. That makes me an overcomer. And you don't have to believe it if you don't want to, but it's true. So we're going to sing about overcoming. Is that all right? Good, Jonathan. Again, feel free to worship and praise the Lord. You know, I'm a Pentecostal preacher. I've been good all season long. I have not taken off and run around this building yet. But I won't do that. But I want you to worship freely. I want you to enjoy yourself. This is all about focusing on Jesus Christ, because he's the reason you're here. And we're so grateful we're in a country that we can do this, where we can sing freely and worship God. Destined to die, poured out for all mankind. God's only Son, perfect in spotless one. You see, he never sinned, but suffered as if he did. All authority, every victory.
Savior, worthy of honor and glory, worthy of all of our praise, you overcame. Jesus, awesome in power forever, awesome and great is your name, you overcame. Worship you this morning. We magnify your name, Lord Jesus, because you're worthy of all the praise this morning. We didn't do it, you did it. You overcame. Power in hand, speaking the Father's plan. You're sending us out, light in this broken land. All authority, every victory is yours. Savior, worthy of honor and glory, worthy of all of our praise. Jesus, awesome in power forever, awesome and great is your name, you overcame. Oh, you overcame, Lord. Because of what you did on the cross, we're able to stand here and proclaim that you overcame. That you're not in the tomb, but you've come out and you're alive and well and working on our behalf, seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. Oh, we'll overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony, everyone overcome. We will overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. Everyone overcome. Blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony, everyone overcome. Savior, worthy of honor and glory, worthy of all of our praise, you overcame. Sing to Jesus this morning. Jesus, awesome in power forever, awesome and great is your name. You overcame. Sing it again. You overcame. You overcame, Lord. Take a couple minutes and worship Him. Lift your hands and acknowledge that He overcame. You overcame. Just say the name of Jesus. just say the name of Jesus. Whatever you came in this morning with, just cry out the name of Jesus, and I guarantee you he'll take care of it. He'll take care of you. I can feel the presence of the Holy Spirit here this morning. He's in this place. And I believe the goal this morning is to make sure that you don't leave this place the same way you came in. I'd like to just sing a song to you real quick.
I want to see you.
Thank you, John. This morning I have someone that I'd like to introduce you to. Some of you have heard her many times before. This is a Match Sunday. And we have many children's programs. Our after-school program that is for free. We do other youth programs. This is a woman who loves children. And she has for many years given to the children of the tabernacle so that we can serve them. She's a woman who understands children's pain. She's a woman that has been blessed in many ways and has chosen for many years to share her blessing with our children. It's my honor to introduce to you one of our trustees, Jane French.
I had my whole speech prepared, but I just want to say two things. I've never been called a woman so many times in one introduction. I said to Paul's husband, I'm really just a young girl. And this, but then I feel very elderly when John helps me up the step, but I said to his wife, I really think it's just because he wants to hold my hand. So we'll see. Hello, my name is Jane French. And this year, with the help of two other trustees, today is a Match Sunday. Since not everyone may know what that means, let me give you the details. Your collection goes to the general funds of running the tab, as usual. But for everyone that gives at least $50 and labels it match, your funds still go to that same general funds. But our matching funds go to the children's programs. Year round, the Tabernacle has many wonderful programs. Remember the cornerstone as you came in this morning at the north exit says, building for our children's children. Well, we have built the narthex, the education wing, and the Cole Youth Center. And now we need to support the programs that we offer there. Now, I know some of you are saying, oops, I'm not prepared, but we're prepared for you. There's no problem here. Just simply fill out one of the envelopes with your name and the word IOU and a dollar amount, and we will accept that as part of our matching program. Lastly, I want to use a very common word not used often enough in the English language today, and that is thank you. Thank you for coming to the TAB. Thank you for your years and years of support of the TAB, and thank you for participating in today's match.
To give once again and to share jointly with you in feeding your people, your flock, not only in word but also in other areas of their lives. Lord, we just ask that you would take this offering, that you would bless the giver, that they would give with a joyful heart, and that we would receive in such a manner that would be pleasing unto you. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning. It's so good to be here to share with you this morning. We'll be here this afternoon. My name's Larnell. This is Simeon on the piano. And in brokenness, he does shine. Amen. Were you there when they crucified my Lord? Were you there when they crucified my Lord? Oh, you know that sometimes it causes me to tremble. And tremble, tremble. Oh, but were you there when and they crucify my Lord. Well, it had to be from a blemishless, spotless lamb. Were you there when they laid him in the tomb? In that instance, our gift would have been no good. Were you there when they crucified, when they laid him in that tomb? You know that sometimes it causes me to tremble. Doesn't that gift tremble and tremble? Oh, but were you there when they laid him in the tomb? I love how this song puts it. Listen. Jesus paid it all. All to him we owe. Why, when sin had crimson stain, my Lord, your price, what did he do? He washed it white as snow. Now, Lord, how can I say thanks for all the things that you have done for me? All those things so undeserved. Yet you give, and you give, and you give, and you give, and you give to prove your love for me. And the voice says, of a million angels cannot express our gratitude for all that I am and I ever hope to be. I owe it all to thee, Father, to my God. Be all the glory to God. Be all the glory to God. Be all the glory for all the things that He has done. And oh, He has done great things. Oh, He, our Lord, your Christ, has done great things. You know what? There's nobody here but us this morning. Let's just do that. Come on. Let's bless His name. Bless His name. Together this morning, right here in the presence of everyone, we bless your holy name and thank you for all that you've done. Oh, bless the Lord.
Bless the Lord.
Oh, my soul. bless the Lord, oh my soul.
Wow. I have to get up and talk after all of this. It's just like, you won't want to miss Larnell tonight. He'll be back at 7 o'clock. And if you have children that are under the age of 5 or 6 and you would like childcare, please just sign into where you sign your children in, just sign up and we'll have childcare for you. I want you to know children are welcome, families are welcome, but if you'd like just a night to sit and listen to the concert, we want to help you out. Any first-time visitors? Anybody brave enough to tell me they're a first-time visitor? Can I see somebody over here? Where are you from? Welcome, Huntington Valley, Pennsylvania. Did you drive in this morning or are you just here? Good, good. Anybody else? Stand up. I see somebody going like this. Oh, welcome. What part of Germany? Bavaria. Wow. Oh, you have delicious pastry. I love your pastry. Anybody else? Over here, stand up. Oh, that's a beautiful place. Whoa, maybe if I come down there, I'll stop and say hi. Welcome, welcome. Did I miss anyone? Newburgh, New York. Oh, New York. Yes, New York. Any New Yorkers here? Welcome, welcome. Morristown, New Jersey. Welcome. You're nice and close. Did you come just to hear the general or are you here on vacation? Vacation. Okay, well, you'll enjoy it. You have a good week here. We have contact cards on the seat in front of you on the back. If you would fill it out and just drop it at the bookstore or the information table. I promise I won't send you a letter every week asking you for money, but we will want to try and stay in touch with you and let you know about the wonderful programs that we have going on. Did you enjoy John Taylor too? He's pretty good. Well, next week at Sunday night service, we have a personal John Taylor concert. So be sure and mark your calendars to come back. And also, Howard Batston will be with us from Dallas, Texas. I understand he has a great story. I've been reading a little bit about some of the work he's done. It sounds magnificent. So I'm really excited. I've never heard Howard myself. Very excited to hear him. But I know you're here this morning to hear a very special gentleman. Jerry was one of the original members of the U.S. Army Delta Force, and he ultimately commanded those elite warriors in combat. Later, he commanded all the Army's Green Berets, as well as the Special Warfare Center and school. He even did a little tour with the CIA, and during the last few years of his Army career, he was Deputy Undersecretary of Defense for Intelligence. That sounds pretty important, doesn't it? Here's the most important thing. Jerry is an ordained minister of God. He spends his life now traveling, encouraging us, Christians, to become warriors in God's kingdom. I've spent some time with him. I had dinner with him last night. And what I want you to know, that what Jerry speaks to you, what he's lived through, what he speaks to you, he lives. He is a warrior for the living God. He's not just a man in a uniform with medals. He speaks it from his heart, and he lives it. Please welcome Jerry Boykin.
Thank you all, and good morning. Good morning. God bless you. Thank you very much. Yeah, we went out with Paula and Jim last night to some Italian restaurant, and I must tell you that I've never had a bigger or better chicken parmesan than I had there last night. I couldn't eat it all. So I said, well, Paula, I'll take half of this back and I'll have it for breakfast tomorrow morning. By 9 o'clock last night, that portion was gone as well. So thanks for the dinner last night. It was great. And thanks for all of you for being here this morning and having me back again. My wife and I really had a great time here last summer, and I'm glad to be back. Unfortunately, she's not with me. She's been up in New York. Interesting story. She's adopted, and she's finally found her birth family. So she was back in New York. The Lord has blessed her in such an incredible way to be able to, at 59 years old, to be able to find her family and get connected with him. So it's been an incredible blessing. And so I'm here, but I'm just delighted to be with you. And this is a special congregation. We had a great service this morning. I know we have some veterans here. So let me see how many of you are military veterans. How many of you have served the country in uniform? Thank you for your service. Thank you very much. And as I always do, I need to know of those of you who just raised your hand, how many of you are Marines? We got a couple of Marines back here. All right, here's what I want you to do. I want you Army veterans to go sit by a Marine, so if I do use a big word, you can explain what it means. So this Marine always wanted to be a drill sergeant. And the reason he wanted to be a drill sergeant was what? So he'd get one of those Smokey the Bear hats, right? He never got to be a drill sergeant. He retired. He went to work for the Virginia State Police. They sent him to the academy. They gave him a Smokey the Bear hat. He would stand in front of the mirror at night at his home. And he'd do his quick draw with his Smokey the Bear hat on. You talking to me? You talking to me? One day he was going down Interstate 95, this car came down there screaming. He put his blue light on, he pulled this car over, and it turned out to be a blonde from California. They talk different, right? And she said, oh, that was so sweet of you to put the little blue thingy on so we could talk on the side of the road. He said, you were speeding. She said, oh, I'm sorry, I didn't know I was speeding. And the whole time he's sitting there adjusting his Smokey the Bear hat, you know, and he's kind of checking himself out in her mirror, you know. He said, show me your driver's license. She said, oh, I don't have it. He said, where is it? She said, California. He said, show me a photo ID. She looked around in her purse and she couldn't find anything, and she finally said, oh, it was a mirror. She said, oh, here's me, and she handed it to him. That Marine took it and looked at it and said, sorry, ma'am, if I'd realized you were law enforcement, I would not have stopped you. Now, here's my secret. My dad spent 32 years with the United States Marine Corps. I grew up around Cherry Point Marine Air Station, and I love the Marine Corps, but I love all of the services, all of you veterans. And trust me when I say to you Navy veterans, Army will win that football game this year. Yes, I know they've lost 13 years in a row. They will win this year. Folks, I am delighted to be with you. Are any of you in here, other than me, concerned about the direction of our nation? Yeah, I'm very concerned. I'm very concerned, but here's what concerns me even more. What concerns me even more is the number of people in this country that have given up, especially Christians. The number of people in the church that I hear now saying, well, it's too late for America. God has given up on America. We're living under God's judgment. Really? Really? You want to give up on this country? After the price that's been paid for this country? Not me. I'm not giving up on America. I don't. Look,
we're suffering because of what we've brought into this nation, because of what we've allowed to happen in this nation. Yes, we're suffering. But God's not finished with us. But what will make a difference in this country is when Christians, people of faith, begin to rise up and put their faith into action and quit running to the sanctuaries and trying to hide from the battle that's going on in this country, because spiritual warfare is raging in this nation and we are the front line of defense. Now, who's the front line of defense in our communities today? Are the very people that are being attacked. And that's the police officers all over America. But have they disappeared? Have they gone and hung out in the police station? Or are they still on the streets of America? Of course, they're still on the streets of America. They're still out there doing their job because they haven't given up, just because they're being killed all over this country now. And that's one of the evils that we've allowed to come into our nation. And when the church rises up, we'll see a change of direction. We'll see a difference here. You know, in 1940, the British Expeditionary Force was ultimately forced off the continent of Europe. Along with a large group of French military, they were evacuated from a place called Dunkirk. And the evacuation was successful because basically everybody in England, everybody in Britain that had any kind of boat whatsoever immediately went to the shores of Dunkirk and helped pull off thousands and thousands of both British and French military. And Winston Churchill had just come into office on a fluke, literally on a fluke. He was under great pressure. His time there was tenuous. He had opposition, and not only the opposition party, but in his own party. People didn't really know what to think of Winston Churchill, but the majority of the Brits were hanging in the balance in terms of whether they wanted to make a deal with Hitler, which so many of the other European nations had done, or whether they wanted to stand and fight against Hitler. Winston Churchill, who at heart was first and foremost a warrior, said, "I'll never make a deal with Hitler. But now what I've got to do is I've got to convince the British people that we cannot deal with the devil, that we've got to stand and fight, because the future of Britain hung in the balance." He knew he would get one shot at it, of convincing the British people not to make a deal with Hitler. And having the support of the British people, and he made the most famous speech of his life in May of 1940, as he stood in the House of Commons and he made the speech that you're all familiar with. And as I can muster my best Winston Churchill voice, this is what he said, but think about this. He stood in the House of Commons and he said, "We shall defend our precious island, whatever the cost. We shall fight on the beaches. We shall fight on the landing grounds. We shall fight in the fields and in the streets. We shall fight in the hills. We shall never surrender." Change the course of history. The attitude, "We'll never surrender." Folks, I'm not ready to surrender this country. I am not ready to give up, and I know that God has not given us up on us. God still has a purpose and a plan for America, and we need to be in the battle to save this country. In 2011, my six precious grandchildren were at our house during Christmas. And I said to the group this morning, you know, all of you that are grandparents, you love to see those grandchildren come. You want to finish that, ma'am? Any of you grandparents want to finish that? And you love to see them go too, right? That's why raising children's a young person's responsibility. But we had three of our six, or the youngest three actually are boys, and at that time they were all under four, and we do not medicate them. And they're wide open. Man, they are loud. They can make noise like you've never heard. And they just, we've set parameters for them, don't misunderstand me, but we let them play. We let them be boys. You know how boys are, man, they will make some noise. When they left and the house was quiet, my wife, she asked me a very simple question, but an important question. She said, "What kind of country are we going to leave for them?" And then she said, "It's not about us anymore, is it? When you reach the point where you're reminding yourself on a routine basis that it's not about me anymore, it's about those grandchildren. About those grandchildren and what they're going to grow up with, what kind of nation our generation is going to leave them with. You've come to a point where you can really be effective. If you're in a relationship with Jesus Christ, it is a point in your life where you can really do something for this country, because it's no longer about you. It's no longer about what you're going to get out of America. It's about what you're going to leave for your grandchildren." You know, it was at that point that I agreed to go back to Washington to become the executive vice president for the Family Research Council. With one of the great leaders, one of the great spiritual leaders in America today, Tony Perkins. I'm his executive vice president. Tony, and he's a Marine, by the way. In fact, I worked 36 and a half years to be a three-star general so I could then go work for a Marine sergeant. Go figure. God's got a sense of humor. But he's one of the great leaders. He's a man that will not compromise. He's a man that stands on principle. He's a good leader. And that was the point at which I agreed to go back and be the executive vice president of the Famer Research Council. Jeremiah 51:50. If you read the ESV version of that, it says, "For you have escaped the sword, now go. Do not stand still, go." I want you to think about this. What that's saying, in my view, is it's not saying run away, flee. It's saying go. You've escaped the sword. I've spared you for a reason. Now go and do something. Go and make a difference. Go and get engaged. Every one of you that knows Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, you've been spared from the sword, have you not? God has told you that if you confess your sins, He's faithful and just to forgive you your sins and cleanse you of all unrighteousness. If you've confessed your sins and accepted Him as the Lord of your life, you are now one of those that has been spared from the sword. God has spared you from eternal damnation and given you a promise of eternal life. You know, in 1993, as I told you that were here last year, as I gave my personal testimony, I was a commander of the Delta Force during the events that we know as Black Hawk Down. I lost 15 men during that battle. I told you that story last summer. Most devastating moment of my life was watching the bodies of 15 of my men being brought in the back of a 5-ton truck, dead and wounded, laying together, and five of their bodies being dragged through the streets of Mogadishu and mutilated and desecrated. But the man next to me was killed. I was wounded. I was hit. We were both hit with a mortar, and I went down, and when I got to my feet, I looked down, and there was the man that standing right next to me was dead. And all I could say was, "God, why him and not me? Why did you spare me? Why did you take him and spare me?" I came home. I never talked to my pastor about it. I never talked to my wife about it. I never talked to my friends about it. It was a private thing between me and God. Why did you take him, God? He has young children. I'm ready to go, God. Why did you take him and not me? In July of 2012, I reported to the Family Research Council as the executive vice president with Tony Perkins, and in less than a month, on the 15th of August, I was sitting in my office and I heard gunshots. As you do as a warrior, I ran to the gunshots. I ran into our lobby just as I saw our building manager wrestling a man to the ground with one arm because the other arm had a bullet hole through it. His blood everywhere. And he was wrestling that man to the ground with his one good arm, and a pistol flew out, and I was about to reach down and pick up the pistol and shoot the man, and suddenly the police burst in. They were literally right there by our building when the shooting started, and they immediately rushed into our lobby. And the man that was there that had shot Leo Johnson, our building manager, told the judge later that he came in and he was going to kill as many people as possible. Tony Perkins and I were the top targets. And then he was going to rub a Chick-fil-A sandwich in everybody's face that he killed. He had 15 Chick-fil-A sandwiches. He had 100 rounds of ammunition. And the judge said, why did you do that? He said, because they're a hate group. The Family Research Council, the leading voice for Christians in Washington, D.C. And he said, they're a hate group. Why do you call them a hate group? He said, because they've taken a stand on biblical marriage. He was an activist from a local LGBT organization, and he was there to kill us because we stood for biblical marriage. As I stood over that man, the Holy Spirit spoke to me. Yes, God will speak to you. And the Holy Spirit said, I spared you for this fight. This is the fight that I spared you for. This is the fight for the soul of America. This is the fight of the future. Folks, if you know Christ as your Savior, you've been spared. You've been spared for a fight. You've been spared for such a time as this. God saved you not because he wants you to hide in the sanctuary of the church. He saved you because he wants you to be a warrior in his kingdom. He wants you to be in this battle. No matter how young you are. We have these young children sitting here on the front row. God will use them. Or no matter how old you are, God will, if you can't do anything else, commit yourself to being an intercessor. Commit yourself to praying for America and for the leaders, and singling out individual leaders and saying, I'm going to intercede for that leader. You can make it the president of the United States, or you can make it the pastor of your church. It doesn't matter. But you can do something, and you have to do something. We got to quit running into the church and trying to hide. I am not saying we shouldn't be in church. No, we should be in church. We should be here because iron sharpens iron. This is where we learn. This is where we develop an understanding of what God expects of us. But when we learn and when we grow and when we put on our whole armor, we should be out there in society fighting against evil. Our founding fathers were spared from the sword, and they created a new nation. They fought a revolutionary war, and they gave us a country that was based on two unique concepts: unalienable rights, rights that come from God, and consent of the governed. Think about it. Those were not concepts that had previously been experienced in world politics. And by the way, you can't separate the Bible from the Constitution. All the freedoms in our Constitution came right out of the Bible. And in fact, it was the pastors of the Black Robe Regiment that ultimately brought about the Revolutionary War by the influence they had on these powerful men. And it was the church that ultimately brought about the Civil War. As they rose up and took a stand against slavery, they brought about the Civil War. It is time for the church now, and I don't mean just the pastors. I'm talking about every individual Christian to start rising up and taking a stand against the evil that we have brought into this country. How on earth How on earth can any Christian sit by and watch people advocating the killing of police in this country and not be so inflamed and determined to do something? That is evil. It's evil in a pure form, that we would allow people in this country to go around advocating the killing of police. But I be honest with you, I know you've had a service here where you honored the police and the firefighters, the first responders, but you know what? We've got to do more. We've got to do more, not just to honor them and to thank them, but we've got to do more to stop this nonsense that's going on in this country today. We cannot continue to let this happen because we got a perfect storm. You got police that are now being targeted and killed and shot and wounded all over this country. And at the same time, you got Black Lives Matters, the new Black Panther Party, Islamic groups, and Marxist groups all working together in unity and targeting our police and encouraging people to target our police. How can we let that go on in this society? Because the last thing you want to see is for the police to say, okay, I'm done. And by the way, police recruiting right now is incredibly difficult. People don't want to come into police anymore. We're letting that happen. So what happened? What happened in this country? What happened from the time of the American Revolution and the unalienable rights and consent of the governed until today? What's happened? The Bible says in Romans 12:2, it says, "And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind." We are conforming to the world. We are taking the world instead of taking the gospel, the Bible, biblical principles. We're taking the world into our lives, into our society. We have to stand against it. We cannot be conformed to this world, and that's exactly what's happening, and that includes in the church. And that includes as individual Christians and as spiritual leaders. And you hear these spiritual leaders, and it just distresses me when I hear these spiritual leaders that say, God has revealed to me that we've got this all wrong. We've had this all wrong for 2,000 years. God has revealed it to me. We're all going to heaven. Oh. That's not true. That's not true. We are, if we've confessed our sins and received Christ as our Savior, that's scriptural. Or God has revealed to me that for the last 2,000 years we've had it all wrong about marriage. You know what I think? I say, yeah, God has revealed something to me too. And that is that you're a false prophet and a coward. You know, I say to my pastor friends, absolutely. I say to my pastor friends, I say, look, brothers, and I do pastors' conferences all over the country. I say, look, do all you can to lock arms with your fellow pastors in this community. Lock arms with them and work with them and be unified with them. But when you go to them and you say, brother, we need to go stand against this issue, or we need to go stand against this issue, and your fellow pastor says, well, brother, now I'm with you on this issue. I believe just like you believe, but you know, I got to be careful because I don't want to offend anybody. Shake the dust off and get away from him as fast as you can, because he's never going to be an ally, because he's a coward. That's what he is. He's a coward. He's afraid of, look, I'm not advocating that you necessarily stay in the kind of trouble that I stay in most of the time. You don't have to say exactly what I say or do exactly what I do, and I do not look for trouble, just so you know. I do not go around looking for trouble, but if you're going to get into battle, you're going to get in some trouble. But ultimately, it's a matter of accountability. Be not conformed to this world. We've got to quit conforming to this world and taking the easy way out and compromising on fundamental biblical issues, and that's what we're doing. That's what we're doing in America. We're compromising on fundamental biblical issues. We're compromising, and we have to quit. Be not conformed to this world. And then we got a lot of Christians that take this attitude, God's in control. I have said it myself, God's in control. And normally what that means when people say God's in control, what it means is, therefore, I'm not going to do anything. Look, I'm going to tell you something. First of all, I don't like following you, brother. That's a really miserable thing for you to have to do to me. Make me follow him. I thought the rapture was going to happen when he was singing. Then I got emotional, and I'm thinking, I got to settle down before I get up there, because I was so blessed by this music. But look, when we start taking the attitude, what everything that's happening is prophetic, therefore, that means Jesus is coming. Therefore, I'm going to be in church, I'm going to worship, and I'm going to praise the Lord and put my money in the thing, but I'm not going to do anything. No, that's not right. That's not what God expects of us. That's not what God expects of us. Micah 6:8, and what does the Lord require of me? Huh? Love mercy? Act justly? And walk humbly before the Lord. Act justly. Act. That is an active word. Act. Act. If we're not just. We're not acting justly as a nation or as individuals when we let some of the nonsense go on that is happening in this country and we make no effort to take a stand against it. We have got to take a stand against evil. In fact, the Bible says in Isaiah 5, woe unto you who call good evil and evil good. Woe is a warning. And when we start calling, as we are doing in this nation right now, we can start calling good evil and evil good. There's a warning. That's a warning. We're going to pay a price for it. But then when you say, well, somebody's going to stand up against us. I know somebody will. I'm going to be praying that the Lord will raise up somebody that will stand against this. Oh, hallelujah. Well, what if you are the somebody? I want you to read Psalms 94. And Psalms 94 says, who will take a stand against this evil? Who will rise up against these evildoers for me? God is not talking to the secular world. He is talking to Christians. He's talking to his followers. We are the ones that must stand up against evil. Now, one of the ways that we stand up against evil is we go to the polls and vote. And for all you Christians that are not planning to vote, shame on you. Shame on you. I don't care if you write a name in. You got to go to the polls and vote. And if you hadn't been voting in the past, get registered and vote. This is not just about President of the United States. This is about your school board. This is about your city council, your county commissioners, your state legislature, your congressman, and your senator, and the President of the United States. Christians, I am so tired of Christians that don't vote. And by the way, 38 million of them didn't vote in 2012 in the national elections. 38 million. That's inexcusable as far as I'm concerned. And 22 million of those were not even registered to vote. Christians, born again, evangelical Christians that didn't vote. That's inexcusable. We got to get in this fight. We got to get in this battle for the soul of America. Be not conformed to this world. We're called to be warriors. Exodus 15:3 says, the Lord is a warrior. The Lord is his name. That's not my words. That's the Bible's words. The Lord is what? A warrior. We've got to quit hiding in the church and saying God's in control and waiting for the rapture and hoping that nobody says anything ugly about us or nobody does anything to us. No. I don't want to die for my faith. I don't even like, believe it or not, as much as I get criticized, I don't like that. Yes, I've got a little sensitive side to me. It's not as sensitive as it used to be, but except with my wife and my grandchildren. Get out of your comfort zone. We're surrounded. There's a saying that came out of World War II, and this was the saying. The saying said, the soldier does not fight because he hates the enemy in front of him. He fights because he loves what's behind him. Think about that. That's the idea of a transcendent cause. You're fighting for your grandchildren and for their future. You're not fighting because you hate anybody or anything that they represent. You're fighting because you love what's behind you and it's worth fighting for. And that's your grandchildren. That's your nation. That's your family. That's the things you hold dear. Leadership is essential today. And the most fundamental thing that we need today are courageous leaders. You know, if you go back to the Bible and you look at the book of Revelation, who are the first people thrown into the lake of fire? Cowards. Cowards. We got a lot of cowards today. We got an awful lot. I'm not calling you a coward. I'm saying in the church as a whole today, we got a lot of cowards because they're conforming to this world because it's easier, because it's less stressful, because it's less dangerous. My wife, I got to tell you, my wife was here last year, and she's just, for those of you who met her, she's just a beautiful woman. Far more beautiful than I am, and I know I'm pretty good looking, but that I can assure you was a joke, okay? Somebody told me the other day, I went in to do Fox News Friday morning. I sat down in a chair, and I always do this, and so I said to the makeup lady right before I went on to do Fox to talk about this $400 million ransom, I said, "Can you make me look like Denzel Washington?" She looked at me and she said, "How about Barney Fife?" Well, okay. I guess you don't have much to work with, I said. But look, my wife, we got threatened about 6 years ago by some Islamic groups I'd been speaking about. I'd been trying to warn people about what was going to happen if we didn't stand against the evils of radical Islam. And I got threatened by, they arrested a bunch of terrorists, Islamic terrorists, and they had my name in their computer, and they were going to capture me and torture me and then kill me. That was their plan. So the FBI notified me, and then my spiritual mentor who ordained me said, "You got to go tell your wife." And I didn't want to tell my wife. And my big concern was if they come after me now, they'll get her too. And I couldn't live with that. So I went home and she backed up next to the sink. And I said to her, I said, "Ashley, here's the scoop." And I laid out for her the threat that was against us. And I said, "Hon, I'm prepared to stop talking about the threat, to just say nothing else about this and just preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. Because if they come after me and they get you, I got nothing to live for." And she's got beautiful green eyes, and she looked down for a minute. She looked back up and she looked into my eyes and she said, "Let me tell you something." She said, "We're both going to stand before the Lord one day." And she said, "I'd much rather say to him, 'Lord, I'm here sooner than I thought I would be,' than to say, 'Lord, I was afraid and I hid.'" She said, "You keep doing what you're doing." And she said, "If they come after us, they get both of us and we'll go together." And then she said, "Now go over there to your brother's pistol store and get me another pistol." I did. That woman, I travel a lot, and she's at home a lot, and I looked the other day, and she's got, in the bedroom, she's got 5 guns and a dog with a nasty attitude. If you come to see me, make sure you call ahead of time. You don't want to be there. Look, in Deuteronomy, Moses told the Israelites, when you go to war, call the officers up here. And they are to say to the people, they are to say, "Is any man afraid? If you are, go on home. Go on home, because you being afraid might infect the other people," basically. My words, you can read it for yourself. But we don't need any cowards here, is what he was saying. The Lord told Joshua in Joshua 1:6, "Be strong and courageous. Be strong and very courageous." This courage. Courage keeps coming back. It's a recurring theme. As individual Christians, we need courage. First and foremost, we either believe God or we don't. We either believe Him when He says, "I'll never leave you nor forsake you," or we don't. But you can't have it both ways. Look, I got just as much of a carnal nature as anybody in here. Let me assure you that I am very much afraid of many things in life, one of which is heights. I got 500 plus parachute jumps. I've jumped as high as 26,000 feet, and I'm scared of heights. I didn't jump out of that airplane because I wasn't scared. I jumped out because I overcame my fear. And I told the audience this morning, the only people that knew just how scared I really was the laundry. You have to overcome your fear. You have to overcome your fear. It's a matter of reflecting on God's word and saying, I can overcome this. I am an overcomer because God said, I'll never leave you nor forsake you. He didn't say, you're never going to get wounded. He said, I'll be there with you. And too many Christians today just simply don't understand. Remember when the prophet Elijah was surrounded with his servant? And the servant said, oh, look at all those people out there. What are we going to do? And the prophet said, open my servant's eyes. And when he opened the servant's eyes, he looked, and on the hillsides all around him were chariots of fire. The prophet said, show him that the army that fights for us is larger than the army that fights against us. And it is that way in every battle that we take on. The army fighting for us is larger. You will not win every skirmish, but you'll win the battle. Courage is in short supply in America. George Patton said, courage is fear holding on a minute longer. All of you Marines, the most famous Marine in history, there's a guy named Chesty Puller. Every Marine in boot camp goes to bed at night and says, good night, Chesty Puller, wherever you are. Highly decorated, very courageous man. He got surrounded in 1950, November, December 1950, at a place called the Chosun Reservoir. 300,000 Chinese had 9,500 American Marines and soldiers surrounded. Chesty Puller was in charge. He was surrounded. He came up on the radio, and this is what Chesty Puller said. He said, all right, they're on the left, they're on the right, they're in front of us, they're behind us. They can't get away this time. Patton said, moral courage is being the only one on the battlefield who knows that you are afraid. Don't think because you feel fear, because you have an instinct. When things start to unfold, your first instinct is fear. Don't think that's because you're a coward. It's because it's human nature. Our first instinct is fear. And then we have to go back to our fundamental understanding of the Bible and God's word and know that He's never going to leave us nor forsake us. He will be there. It takes courage not to surrender. That's the kind of courage that Churchill had. A little artillery officer, 5'6", named Tony McAuliffe, was the commander of the 101st Airborne Division at a place called Bastogne in the Battle of the Bulge. He never should have been there. First of all, he wasn't even an infantry officer. He was an artilleryman. Secondly, he got lost and wound up in Bastogne by mistake. Thirdly, he wasn't the commander. He was actually the deputy commander, and the commander was in England. He wound up at the Battle of the Bulge, totally surrounded. He was surrounded by at least a ratio of 5-1, Germans to Americans. In some places, it may have been as high as 10-1. And finally, they had the city of Bastogne surrounded, and the Germans sent a courier to Tony McAuliffe, and this is what the courier said. There's only one possibility. This is the note. There's only one possibility to save the encircled American troops from total annihilation, and that is the honorable surrender of the encircled town. Tony McAuliffe sent them back a one-word reply. What was it? Nuts. That was the one-word reply sent back to them, nuts. You feel like we're surrounded? You feel like we're surrounded by evil? We are. But God's army is still bigger. But we got to turn the tide. We got to start standing up against evil. We got to start calling things evil. Let me tell you that I do not care how people have sex. That's between them and God. But what I do care about is when they try to rob me of my freedoms because of how they have sex. Larnell is in Kentucky. There's a woman there named Kim Davis, one of the sweetest women I've ever met. She has lived a hard life. How many of you know who I'm talking about? She is the Kentucky clerk that would not sign a same-sex marriage license. She had only known Christ as her Savior for 4 years at the time. She had had a hard life. She'd been through multiple husbands, multiple relationships. But then Christ came into her life, and she just said, you know, as a matter of conscience, I cannot sign this. I can't do it. It violates my faith. And they said, well, we'll lock you up. She went before the Lord, and the Lord said, yep. Said, I'm going to let them put you in jail. But don't worry, I'll be with you. You ought to hear her tell this story. When the judge said, in that case, I'm remanding you to the county jail for a period of whatever. You know what she did? Did she break down and start weeping? Oh, God, woe is me. How could you let this happen? No, she raised her hands and said, thank you, Lord. People in the courtroom said, what's she doing? She raised her hand and said, thank you, Lord, because the Lord said, in doing what I've called you to do, I'm going to let them put you in jail. These big old bailiffs were standing there, shocked. The judge put her in jail. They were shocked. The judge said, put the cuffs on her. These bailiffs didn't want to cuff her. What did she do? She looked at them and she said, no, it's okay. Go ahead. Go ahead. It's okay. It'll be all right. They cuffed her. They took her over to fingerprinter. The women that had the fingerprinter were weeping. She said, don't worry, just here. Come on, I'll help you. She stood for what she believed in. You see, what society is trying to tell us today is that we have freedom of worship, not freedom of religion. Our founding fathers gave us freedom of religion, which means I can believe what I want to believe and I can practice my faith, to include in the public square. But what's happening today is that there's much in our society that's trying to say to us, no, you only have freedom of worship. You do not have freedom of religion because you can't do what Kim Davis did. You can't say, as a matter of religious conviction, I can't do this. I'm going to take your business if you won't bake a cake for same-sex marriage. I'm going to take your Photoshop if you won't do the photography. I'm going to take your wedding gown shop if you won't make a wedding gown. And it's happening all over America. That's freedom of worship, not freedom of religion. We've got to exercise our rights as Americans and as Christians to live our faith, to be able to live our faith in the public square. And I'm telling you, if we don't start standing up right now, this is the only place you're going to be able to worship. Because right now in Germany, they're kicking doors in, and they're going in homes in Germany because somebody said something and it was overheard about Islam. Check the records. They're kicking doors in and arresting Germans who have spoken against Islam as a matter of conscience, as a matter of faith, and they're being arrested because they call it hate speech. And the same thing is unfolding right now in America. We've got to have some courage. You know, the next generation is going to know us either as the generation that saved their future or the generation that sacrificed it at the altar of political correctness. We've got to stand up. I'm going to wrap this up. I've got two books that I'll be out there selling and signing. One is my autobiography, Never Surrender. The other one is a book that I wrote with a guy that was a Green Beret in Vietnam, Pastor Stu Weber from Portland, Oregon. Some of you guys may remember him from the Promise Keepers movement, and he's quite a warrior himself, and we wrote a book called The Warrior's Soul. So I'll be signing and selling those. We've got to have leadership that has courage. I could go through and tell you war story after war story about the kind of leadership that I've seen under very difficult situations. But since I told the first audience, I'm going to tell you this before I close. Courage is the most important thing we need today in Christians, in Christianity. And I saw a guy one night 100 miles from Tehran as we were trying to rescue 52 Americans that were being held by the Ayatollah Khomeini. A helicopter landed on top of an airplane that were sitting on the desert floor as we were doing that operation, and the fuselage filled with flames, and the loadmaster couldn't get the door open, and a big old arm came up and knocked him out of the way and popped that door open. It was the command sergeant major of that squadron, big Yaqui Indian from Yuma, Arizona. And then he took a stand right next to the door on the inside of the aircraft, and he started saying, "One at a time, boys, one at a time. One at a time, don't panic, you're all going to get out, one at a time." And when the last man cleared the door, he risked his life because he was the leader. He was a man of courage. And they listened to him that night because they knew he was a man of courage. When the last man went out, he went out right behind him. That's the kind of leadership we need right now. Leaders that are courageous, leaders that care, leaders that are more committed to the country and to the faith than they are to themselves and the size of their congregation and their own popularity. Where do you stand in your faith today? Bow your heads with me, would you please? Do you know Lord? Do you know Christ? Is he the Lord of your life? I want you all, everybody in here, out loud to pray this prayer with me. Let's pray this prayer. Now, if you want to, right now, you want to show me your hand. If you are one who wants to know Christ as your Savior today, show it to me real quick and put it back down. Yes. Yes. See you. Others. Others. You want to know Christ? Put your hands up and put them right back down as soon as I see them. Others? Yes, I see you. Put it down, sir. Yes, sir, I see you. Put it down. Yes, sir, I got you in the back. Yes, sir, I see you over here. Yes, ma'am. Yes, sir, I got you both. Put them down. Any others? So I can see you individually. All right, listen carefully. All of you in here together, including those of you who just raised your hand, pray this prayer with me. Heavenly Father, forgive me, for I'm a sinner. I can't save myself, but I trust you, Lord, to wash away all my sins. I receive you, Lord, as my Savior, as my Redeemer, and I make you, Lord, the Lord of my life. With your help, I'll serve you for the rest of my life. In Jesus' name, amen. Listen carefully. If you just prayed that prayer for the first time, your sins are as far as the east is from the west. That's what the Bible says, not my words. God has forgotten them. You're redeemed. You're clean. You're in a relationship with Jesus Christ. Now try to grow in that relationship. You grow by getting with people around you that know what it means to live a Christian life. You aren't going to be perfect. You're going to have difficulties here and there. But I'm asking you now to accept that Jesus just washed away all your sins. That's all it took. And now you are in a relationship with Jesus Christ. And the Bible says that right now at this moment, because those people raised their hands and prayed that prayer, the angels in heaven are rejoicing. We should do the same. God bless you and thank you all.
Well, you heard the general say it so eloquently. The bottom line is, when we call on the name of Jesus, everything will be okay. So we're going to sing "There's Something About That Name" as our closing hymn. Which one are we doing? Oh, yeah.
It is. There's something about that name. 104. They're trying to confuse me. Okay. Jesus, 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 there's just something about that name. Master, Savior, Jesus, like a fragrance after the rain. Jesus, 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 let all heaven and earth proclaim. Here's the good news. Kings and kingdoms will all pass away, but there's something about that name. Now may the God of glory, may he cause his face to shine upon you. May he guide your footsteps, protect you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We'll see you tonight at 7 o'clock for Larnell. You won't be disappointed.